I'm Margot. I'll be moderating this session. We ask that you submit your questions for the Q&A in the Q&A section, and questions will be queued in the order received. Today, we'll start out with listening to Jaco Kluta. He is a thoroughly certified professional with 22 years of experience in cyber risk management and has been responsible for both external and internal auditing across information technology and cyber domains. He is responsible for everything from cyber strategy, policy, risk management to red team testing, playbooks, and metrics. So his talk is Boom, Now What? It's a talk about navigating the aftermath of a cyber incident, where the processes and inner workings of the organization are key elements. And I have to say that in a landscape of steady increase in attacks and compromises, this should absolutely be top priority. So I'm excited to hear this, and over to you, Jaco.
Thank you very much for that introduction. So I want to talk to you about Boom, Now What? It's not about your typical technical response to an incident that's happened, but more about the business response. We are used to technical response and how to solve an incident technically, but what is lacking is the business response to that. And we have many examples in the industry where companies get it wrong because they have very good technical response, but they mess up on the business response side of things. So most organizations have a cyber resilience program in place, and we all put some reasonable controls. We activate some good controls, and we have everything up to a certain level of maturity. Now, some of these controls that we implement, security standards like your NIST standards and all those nice things. We build maturity frameworks. We perform threat modeling. We know who's it going to attack us. We know how they're going to attack us, where they're going to strike, how to defend against those things. We identify our crown jewels, what are all the important critical assets that we have in the organization that can cause great harm to the organization. We have technical response in place, your SIM, your SOC, your SOAR. We have CERTs in place. We do red team testing. Red team, blue team testing, penetration testing. We even have cyber MIS metrics, and we measure it against risk appetite. We have all the good technical controls in place across the estate and the IT processes. So everything is going well and going fine. But one day, there's a hack. Boom. Now what? What do we do? That can be at a third party. It can be inside the organization. No, it's something that's going to happen at some point, even if you have the best controls, because we have to defend many, many, many attack paths that can come into an organization where the hackers just need to find one to get in. Now, what must organizations do? They must have a cyber crisis management plan, and that must be supported by a cyber crisis management team. And I'm going to talk to you a little bit more about what does such a plan look like, and what does this team look like, the CCMT. How it's constituted, what roles need to be played by different parties, etc. So the impact of a cyber incident can be very big. You can have the best organization that runs smoothly, make a lot of money, everything goes well, you know, top 500 company, whatever. And then you have a cyber incident. And overnight, your organization can become, you know, terminal and not exist the next day anymore. So to respond to that, you need a comprehensive business response and not only a technical response. So if you look at that diagram at the bottom, you can see it's split into two sections. On the left-hand side, you have your typical attack path. I'm using three risks there. And on the right-hand side are some of the consequences of such an attack. So let me quickly talk about the loss of money, the loss of data, and the loss of systems. So in the first example, where you hacker steals, let's say, a bank's money through a compromised payment switch or ATMs and withdraw money from the ATMs. The second one, hacker steals a client database through SQL injection, and it lands up on the internet. And the third example is hacker implements ransomware that locks up the Windows estate, and now we have to respond to that. So all of these things can cause great reputational damage. There can be social media fallout, loss of market share, regulatory fines, or even a liquidity crisis where the clients decide that they want to withdraw their money from the ATMs and they want all of their money out now. All of these things are very big impacts that have to be solved through a business response. Now, your cyber crisis management team plays a very important role. It's coordination between all the key stakeholders group in the organization, key functions internally, as well as externally. Smaller incidents, you can still, that can be run by the CISET. It's not to say that for every incident you have to call a CCMT. So the small things like a small virus outbreak or something like that, CISET can still handle. But for the larger incidents, the CCMT have to be called and invoked. And typically you will have your three or four key people that makes that call, like the CISO, CIO, risk executive, like the chief risk officer, or the business executive. They will make the call. And then what are some of these key aspects that you have to take into consideration for deciding whether to invoke the CCMT? These things on the right-hand side. Is it public or likely to go public? Because if it goes public, your reputation is at stake. Does it impact the financial markets? Let's say you're a big company, big tech company, and your share price plays a big role on the indices and so on. That is very big. Is the situation worsening, for example, that you are getting into a terminal state? Will it attract regulatory attention? Is personally identifiable information at stake? Will it have a big operational impact to the bank, like or to the organization, like maybe the organization might become terminal? In these cases, you will typically call a CCMT. Now, what is the constitution of the CCMT? So the CCMT consists of representation from various important functions in the organization. So first of all, you have your CISO. The CISO will typically run with the CCMT. It will be the lead, do overall communication, coordination, communication to the CEO and the board, as well as the industry bodies. Tapping into trusted circles, the sector, industry, all of that type of communication will be done by the CISO. Checking that everything in the war room is running smoothly. And I'll talk more about the war room shortly. Your privacy officer will get involved when there's a privacy incident, as well as when there needs to be communication with the information regulator. Then, your corporate communication is one of the most important departments and functions of the CCMT, because the corporate communications will put together all your communication collateral, develop all of those things, because they have the experience to talk to the media, they know all the people, they know the media people, they know the social media people, etc. So they will be the primary liaison with the media. Then your impacted business unit executive. So it happens so many times that business is not part of this whole incident process. So business must be involved, and it must be the executive of that business that must be sitting in the room, that must be seeing what's going on and take the message back into the business, into their management committees, etc. Otherwise, it's just like a phone call and saying, how are things going with solving the incident? It's actually the business executive's prerogative to be part of this and drive it from a business perspective. Then your legal counsel. The legal counsel will review all communications because it's possible to say something that's wrong from a legal perspective, provide legal advice, emergency contracting with suppliers, because in that time of crisis, you might be have to engage with a supplier that you don't have contracts with and bypass some of the procurement processes, and the legal counsel can quickly draw up contracts, whatever is necessary. Your group insurance. Remember that insurance companies want to be part of this. You must maintain your cover. You must not do anything that will breach your policy. And sometimes the group insurance will also approve The insurance company will approve which suppliers you are allowed to use during an incident for incident response, etc. Your social media team, that's very important. They approve all social media. They maintain, they check for market sentiment. They check for all the hashtags, everything that happens in social media, and feed that back into the CCMT, as well as maintain the microsite, which is a site specifically dedicated for everything, all information of this incident, as well as any website content you might want to update. Then you have your CCERT, which deals with all the technical response matters, as well as engaging with the dark web and monitoring if anything of this incident pops up on the dark web. The CCERT will normally have those type of connections. It's always a good idea to have a crisis management consultant handy to help you if any if there's any overflow needed or support, or any phone a friend, or if they have dealt with similar type of incidents at other organizations and how that played out, just to give some advice. Your contact center would be your main contact with your clients. And during a time of crisis, there will definitely be people phoning in, and therefore your contact center must be part of this. Your investor relations, because your market price might be impacted and your price could go down. The investors will be phoning shareholder analysts, rating agencies. All those people must be kept informed if necessary, and therefore your investor relations must be part of the CCMT. And then as well, your forensic department that will be monitoring for funny things that happen, fraudulent activities, engaging with your law enforcement. They have the contacts for that, as well as if there's any forensic work that might need to be done internally in the organization. If we look at the logistics of the CCMT, so you must have a war room ready at all times, a hot room that is well equipped. And this room must be not be used for anything else, preferably, so it can be utilized as soon as an incident happens. You must have a war room protocol. And these are some of the points that form part of that protocol. So stakeholders should visit regularly. So all these people in these groups that I've mentioned must be regularly coming into the war room. Anyone else that need to, like the CEO, for example, if the CEO wants an update of what's going on, the CEO must come to the war room and he can get the updates there. It's the primary location for all updates on the latest status and response efforts. And all information that is given to the stakeholders must come from the CCMT in the war room based on whatever intervals you decide, whether it's daily or hourly, depending on the situation. The regular check-ins must be held at minimum daily, and no activity relating to this incident is allowed to happen unless it's authorized by the CCMT. So nobody does nothing unless they get to go ahead off from the CCMT in the war room. And then, of course, it might be that you are 24/7 in that war room, sitting there, working through the nights, dealing with this incident, all the logistics regarding data analysis or finding out what happened or how big the problem is. It can take days, 24/7, and the catering must be there and people must be looked after. And then your project management tracking is also done by the CCMT in the war room, and you can have like a board that's on the wall, or you can have whatever mechanism you prefer to keep track of all the actions that you must do. I'm going to show you an example of one of these things that you can do. There on the right-hand side, you can see a project plan extract from that, where you can update everything that's happening from modus operandi. You understand what has happened and gather information. Your pre-approval comms strategy, you prep your oil comms material, decide what market segments you are going to be targeting for your when you go public with this, and what channels you'll be using, whether you'll be using email, SMSs, other social media groups, or websites, or the contact center, etc. Query mechanisms, you must decide how you are going to deal with any queries that come in. For example, you might be pushing a website or a microsite, or help desk scripts or even a dedicated email box or a dedicated helpline number that you might generate. You must assign your spokespeople, preferably your CEO must be the primary, because it's very important that you show to the public that you mean business, that you know what you're doing, that this incident gets the highest attention at the organization, therefore your CEO must be the primary person. The CEO is also the person that is going to be getting the calls for television interviews and radio interviews and those type of things. Then other things that you can do, notify your regulators, creating a mobile group, comms group for the CCMT. It's important that you don't do your communications just over email, because your email server might be hacked and the hackers might be monitoring what you are saying. So just use some kind of a out-of-band communication through one of the social media platforms between the group if you need to communicate. And then also your post strategy, how to brief the board, how to brief the exco of the company, the staff, the clients. And the important thing is staff is the same as the public. The first staff member that gets information from the CCMT, that will go straight to the media. So you must be have your strategies in place for how to handle staff as well, your press comms, all those type of things that you need to do. Then ensuring that your timing is correct for all of these steps, because let's say your help desk must be trained, because and it might be that it takes half a day to train your help desk. So before you go live and public, make sure that you put those lead times in place and train your help desk and staff as necessary, so that when you go live, they are all trained and know exactly what to say when they get trained. When you do a communication strategy, there are some very important principles that you must take into account. The first one is that you must put the regulators and your clients first. You must not delay informing the regulators. Be very quick with that, because that's extremely important. And your clients. Your clients must not hear of this incident from other people or the media or that. They must be the first people that you notify, because they are the victims. Be honest and build trust. Don't lie. Don't give misinformation, because that impacts your credibility. And it will always catch up with you. If you start lying and not telling the truth, after a short while, you'll have to start backtracking and you just get yourself entangled in a big mess. Portray competence. You must tell the people and the public what you are doing. You have it under control, and it must be clear from your response that you know exactly what you are doing. Provide regular updates, because people want to know what's happening to their money, what's happening to their data, etc. Social media and microsite. Have your social media comms and so on ready, as well as your microsite, where you put all the information for the public to consume. Keep to the facts and don't speculate. So don't think, yeah, maybe this happened or maybe that happened and so on. If you don't know, then say, I don't know, but I'm working on it and I will get the information and I'll tell you as soon as I have this information, but keep to the facts. Use the right tone. Never play the victim. You're not the victim. The clients are the victim. It's their money that's lost. It's their data that got stolen. And sympathize and apologize if need be. If you did something wrong, apologize. Say, sorry, I messed up here, but I'm solving and I'm sorting it out. Maintain confidentiality. So nothing leaves the war room or the CCMT. It's trusted people. They don't talk out, and you don't share any information out of that room. Only authorized comms goes out, and then all comms are facilitated by the CCMT. Now, reporting in a time of crisis, there are some guidance available from the Bank of International Settlements, Basel Committee on Banking Supervision Standard 239, which is Principles for Effective Risk Data Aggregation and Risk Reporting. It's 14 principles that apply to banks, but it's good practice for organizations to look at. And of particular importance are three principles, which is that your architecture and infrastructure must support reporting during a time of crisis, that you must generate accurate information through automated mechanisms so that you have that accurate data available in a time of crisis. And then also that you must be able to produce on-demand and ad hoc scenarios. You must be able to cater for that. I'm going to show you one mechanism and method of how you can do that by building a proper cyber MIS system. So there on the left-hand side, you can see a generic design. Now, this metric system can be used for many different things, but it will also come in extremely handy during a time of crisis. Here at the bottom, you can see all your data sources, where you pull data from different sources, whether it's third parties or server data or Active Directory data or whatever data you want to utilize. Those data gets pulled in through ETL tools or API, those land in tables in your data reservoir. And then in your data mart, you build models of everything that you want to measure, from a workstation to a user, to a server, to a third party model, you name it. You can have as many models as you want. And all the attributes of those models come from some kind of a data source. And then if you apply this process to your third parties, on the right-hand side, you can see there your supplier master data, your external risk profile data, any manual supplier data that you might have, any governance checklist that you might have. For example, what data am I sending to third parties? Is there PI data involved? Do these guys have contracts with them? Have they been checked? What's their location? All of that type of information. And then supplier control environment, for example, the question sets that the supplier answers about their control environment, that can be pulled into this model as well. And then any other profile data points that you want to capture in, let's say, into your workflow tool. So with all of this information in a workflow tool, this view gets published either via a database like SQL or straight into a data warehouse. Now, in a time of crisis, let's say you had a data breach with a third party and you want to know, I want to know all the third parties where this type of data is sent to. Quickly, you pull the information out of your MIS system because you have it handy, you've built the proper system. Or let's say my Swift is a crown jewel, my Swift environment, and now Swift got hacked and some money stolen through Swift. So what's all the servers, all the workstations, all the users that's relevant to Swift? And because crown jewel indicator was part of your model, you can quickly pull that information, know exactly who's the users involved. It will help you in your investigation and all, answer all those questions that the CEO might have or from you in such a time of crisis. From a documentation perspective, so all the documentation must be in place. So there are two things that you can do. The first is you can do it at a laminate with all the critical information that people can keep with them, like a quick start guide. And CCMT members can keep that with them. Or what you can do is you can do a comprehensive cyber crisis management plan that contains all the key elements of handling a crisis. And some of those are listed below. Your communication strategy principles that tells you the do's and the don'ts of when communicating. All your different stakeholders, how are you going to engage with them? And what mechanisms are you going to do to engage with them? Your target audiences, how are you going to deal with the media, with your regulators, with staff, etc.? Who are the official spokespeople? Your process flows, what's the handoffs and the take-ons and the handoffs during this process of the different functions and how they all interact? Your CCMT roles and responsibilities for each stakeholder, like that table that I talked to you about earlier, that must be documented. The logistics of the war room, who are the people that are authorized to be part of this, your severity criteria, your actions of what you must do, you know, checklist within 24 hours, within 48 hours, within 72 hours and longer, so you don't miss anything. And then your comms collateral, because you can already do some holding statements, help desk scripts, staff comms, social media messages for typical scenarios, and that can be in your plan. And as an incident happens, then afterwards you can take all of that, the real stuff that happened, and you can update your plan by adding that to your collateral. And then in the next time you can, if something like that ever happens, and hopefully it won't, but then you have some more information you can use to start the process, and you don't have to do everything from scratch. And then very important, frequently asked questions, as well as questions and answers, because you have to prepare your spokespeople, like your CEO. The CEO must be portrayed as confident. CEO must know what happened, everything, and all of that Q&A, because the person on the interview might ask the CEO some questions, and then the CEO must be properly prepared. And then from a testing perspective, it is very important that your plan gets tested regularly with some realistic scenarios. For example, let's say this quarter you will test a breach of the third party. Then everybody plays their part and they come together, the war room is activated, CCNT is activated. What's very important is that the executives must be part of this test from a real life incident as well as a test. And as well as you can have your electronic version, which is available on the network, as well as a physical copy of the plan in the battle box in the war room. But also you get some commercial tools where you can code your plan in, and then people can see that on their mobile devices, which is very handy. And then, in summary, just to highlight again the important things that I talked about, you must have a crisis management plan, as well as a cyber crisis management team. The plan must have all these things documented that I've just talked about. Ensure appropriate membership of the CCNT. All parties must understand their role, and they will have to also play their role when they get together during the testing. And make sure that the logistics are in place of the CCNT. Make sure that you design and apply a robust communication strategy with following all the good practice principles that I talked about. Executive participation, extremely important in a time of crisis. And then develop your automated MIS system to facilitate accurate and timely information during a crisis. And I believe that if you apply all of these things that I talked about, there will be a good chance that you can get through this incident with minimal impact to your organization. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. We don't really have much time, I'm sure, because the room will close. But the first question was, given current situation, any thoughts on making the war room virtual?
To make the war room virtual?
Yeah.
It's possible to do a virtual war room, especially during a time like COVID. But it works very well in a physical room where people can talk to each other and people can come in and come out. It might be just a little bit difficult to manage the virtual people that joins and come on and come off in a virtual, but it's very possible to do a virtual war room.
Okay. Is there any crisis management software you would recommend?
So I wouldn't talk about the names of specific products, but there is a product that's used for business continuity planning, for example, that's in the cloud that works very well. It can cater for business continuity plans, but it can also cater then for, you can adapt it slightly to program your cyber crisis management plan in a very similar way that you do business continuity plan.
All right. Also, do you think you need to alter the organization's normal hierarchy of reporting during a cyber crisis?
Can you repeat that question?
Do you need to alter the organization's normal hierarchy of reporting during a cyber crisis?
No, you don't have to do that, because the cyber crisis management team in the time of a crisis is sort of one of the ultimate, you know, it's the survival of the business. So It sort of goes above traditional hierarchies. You pull in executives, you pull in whoever you need to pull in for that CCNT. So you don't have to change the functional or the organizational hierarchy. Just make sure that all the key people, executive level, and all the important people in the organization from those functions that I mentioned are pulled in a matrix structure into the CCNT.
I don't think we have much time, but a final one. How often do you test your plan?
So plans should be tested at least quarterly, because it's such a big thing. To get time in the diaries of the CEOs and the other board members and business executives, it's very difficult to do. So you can probably plan about 4 tests for a year and make sure that you do that at the end of the previous year or the beginning of a year. So that they have that time available, and then you take out half a day or so to go through your scenario.
All right, thank you. I don't think we have much more time, since the next session starts in a couple of minutes. So, but thank you so much. It was very interesting.
Thank you very much.
And see you all.